Thank you. I'm primarily going to deal with cyber crime, cyber forensics, what we are doing, the need for awareness on cyber security, what you can in one sense do to ensure that you don't get hacked, you don't, and looking at some of the things which the government is currently doing. I think first, we have to understand that cybersecurity is a very complex subject. If you can blame any, a lot of problems in India, please be assured that this is a problem that is faced by every country in the world. The director of CIA's phone has been hacked, his computer has been hacked, and what is available in that is now available on my mobile phone. If the director of CIA in America can be hacked, you can imagine what is the strength of what I call as the hacking community. I don't think I would be wrong if I say there is nothing you can do to prevent yourself from being hacked. As they say, there are only two types of people, those who know they have been hacked and those who don't know they've been hacked. 97% of people, computers, websites, etc., have been hacked. We also know that it takes about between something like about 4 to 6 months before even the best companies in the world come to know that they have been hacked. And therefore, this is something which we have to live with. I'll come to some of the issues, how you can tackle some of these issues. I'll come to that later. But I think if you look at, I'll just cite a few examples. And it's not something which is, it's very, very common, how you need to be careful. The director of the IIT Kanpur, retired a few years ago, got his pension, gratuity, all the provident fund, etc. And he found out 3 months later when he went to his bank balance was zero. So in spite of having your SMS alert and so on and so forth, he found that, he said, I got no SMS alert. The bank said, of course we sent you the SMS alert. What happened was, it's so easy that if you are slightly careless at the bank, on a letterhead of the director IIT Kanpur, you put in a letter to the branch manager saying that my mobile phone was so and so, I have now changed, I've got a new mobile number, put it together, sign it, nobody is really watching it in the bank, it's a clerk who is doing this. He takes the application, changes the official records, and the alerts go to the other number. At this moment, as I talk to, and I'm telling you as a former Union Home Secretary, more than something like about 200,000 computers in India, from Prime Minister's office to government departments to state governments to ISRO, you name it, all information from some of these computers are actually going to 3 universities in China on a real-time basis. We've looked at a classic case of what is called in the Vishakhapatnam, when we had the naval base, totally LAN, local area network, not connected to the outside internet and so on and so forth. And all the information about the nuclear submarine which that base was doing leaked out. How did it come? Because one of the naval commanders at some conference, he was given as a gift a pen drive, which by carelessness, he took it inside the command center and put it onto his computer, and information completely went out. So one of the first things to learn is that in any internet, any conference, any seminar, anything, anybody gives you a gift, please leave it behind. Anything electronic gift, please leave it behind and leave the conference. Because if you don't, you are certain to, if you use that, your computer is completely compromised. India is a very complex country. You have people who are very advanced living in the 21st century, and you have also people living in the, what I would call as the 19th century. And with all due respect to my friend from Dubai, in India, you will never be able to do it as some of the developed countries in the world do it. We are going to be what we call as the Jugaad model of development. That is the only way it will function, because there is a whole pile of systems which are not going to, we are a huge country, 1.2 billion people, we got hundreds and thousands of villages, people are illiterate and so on and so forth. How do you do it? And therefore you will make compromises. And I'll give you this simple example of recently you had financial inclusion, which you all talked about, the program Jan Dhan, accounts were opened in most remote areas. And they did, this is a study which has come out recently. They went to a particular village when they did a survey, and they found that 60 farmers in a village have got accounts opened in a branch of a bank, which is about 25 kilometers away from the village. And all the money is being put there. And they asked these people, how do you, you can't travel 25 kilometers, there's no hardly any transport, there's a single bus you can't hold, people in the village cannot go. And you know what, how would they do it? There's a bus which comes, and all the people in the village who've got this bank accounts under the Jan Dhan program, they give their ATM cards, they give their PIN, and they give it to the driver of the bus. He goes to the bank, draws the money, and in the evening he comes back and gives the people in the village the money. It's worked, total trust in the village. The driver cannot, he's in that village, there's a social circumstance, this is the system, it's working now 8 months without a single paisa or rupee being misappropriated. This is the way sometimes it has to do, because this is where we are in India. We expect that everybody is going to get a bank account or a system which is there. And therefore, this is some of the things that we will try and do as we are trying to build this whole digital security network. He mentioned about the Digital India platform, which is a 70,000 crore program which is covering 6 lakh villages. You want every village panchayat to be covered in the next 2 years, by December 2017. The problems for many of these areas when you want to draw the optical fiber line is, it's not that easy in India. There are so many court cases. If you want to draw a line through some farmer's fields, you want to draw a line through the road, people are saying, no, not through my field. And nobody is looking at a larger interest of Digital India. I've got a major project in Kasargod, power transmission line held up for the last 6 years. Why? Because the people on that area say, we don't want lines to be drawn through our fields, the power transmission lines which go under the field, because they say it affects our farming. What do? You have to respect, we live in a democracy. If the majority of the people say we don't want lines to go through our field, there's nothing you can do about it. You have to try and persuade them, you have to try and convince them, but if they're not convinced, what can you do? And this is a challenge which we have in democracy in India, in such a large country with so many different hopes, different aspirations, and people looking at different aspects of it. We have the cyber security policy, and I want to tell you that the cyber security policy has come out in 2013. And many of you, I'm not going to go, you've seen the main steps in the cyber security policy. And I must say, very confess, there's a cyber security coordinator has been appointed. You've got a number of aspects which have been done post. But we still haven't, in one sense, resolved the issue of total coordination. Departments, agencies still function in silos. Lack of communication between department and agencies is something which is endemic to India. We are very highly egoistical people. We believe that it's my turf, my territory. I don't see the larger picture. Budget comes to me, it's my budget. I expand, I create more staff, I become a create one empire for myself. Other person can go down. And that is why you will find that people are still working in silos and people are working in different. You've got, Prime Minister came to the NASSCOM summit and he said, out of 31 heads of states which I met, 28 told me that cyber crime is the most important issue as far as the top 3 issues. And so he said, why don't you come up with a program? NASSCOM has now set up this task force. The task force report is ready. We hope by the end of the month, the task force report recommendations will. We've had as far as possible a wide consultation across industry, across agencies, into the ministries and so on. But I still feel that there are so many areas where we have not even consulted people. But you can't also in one sense, because this is only a draft report. Cybersecurity awareness is important because we're spending now almost, we're talking in terms of thousands of crores for cybersecurity awareness. There are on the website, if you go any website, if you go in cybersecurity, what tips should I take? There are any number from Australian 30, 31 points, some other countries. If you follow some of those points, 85% of the hacking that is, takes place, you can avoid. And they're very simple things. Don't open a mail which from somebody you are not aware of. Be careful about all these spams which come. The Nigerian, be careful about your SMS alerts. Please, any time some alert comes, please keep checking with your bank. If you find a drop in your income, if you got mobile phone, keep checking your bank balance. If your bank balance starts going down without your, and it is very small amounts. Some of them are just, you know, 100 rupees, 500 rupees, and you may not even notice it. If you got a few lakhs, but you have to notice it because these are the ways that people skim off money and very large cases. So this whole issue of building, and countries in the Western world have got a lead start among us. They are far ahead because their system is with them. They've managed to push their technology, and they will not even come to even to share information with you because they are in a comfortable world. United States is comfortable, China is comfortable, UK, Russia, they are comfortable with system because they have one largest set of hackers in the world are from these countries, including Iran now. So what is happening is that you have, in India, we have really in one sense, and I put it that way, it's only offensive. You cannot be defensive. If you want to get a world order on legislation to come together, you will have a place in the world only if you become a very aggressive hacker and you start hacking into the system. I've been to the CGHQ in UK, which is their MI6 or whatever it is. And if you see, it's between what, 14 and 19, boys and girls wearing small tops, jeans, etc. They're all just recruited from school and early college, and they're given this huge computers with the broad bandwidth and just told, go and hack into the world, hack into Pentagon, hack into anywhere you want to go, just hack. And they've got about thousands of them. And they work for 3 years, they paid money, then they go, because these are the youngs. You can't have, I think, anybody above the age of 30, 35, etc. In this cybersecurity conference, I think you are just come for listen. You are out of date. Because it's only people who are between 14 and about 25, I think, who are got their feel on the pulse. The rest are all looking at something which has happened earlier. In fact, we had a University of Cambridge startup which has come recently. He was telling us, he said they have literally done mathematical analysis to say that you cannot prevent hacking. But what you can do, and that is where all the new methods of is coming, is to make sure that the information, once it's got into your system, you can detect that and make sure that the information doesn't go out of your system. But if he's coming in purely to deny services, to destroy your thing, there's literally nothing you can do. And you've seen now the US Department of Justice has taken a case against five Chinese people who belong to the People's Liberation Army. You may not be able to catch them, but the pressure is being put. But the pressure really comes what? US and China will come to an agreement. How, okay, you don't touch my sensitive areas, I won't touch your sensitive areas. What about the rest of the world? Yeah. And the last, I'll end with what I keep telling you. When I attended the last one of these cybersecurity conferences, the top cybersecurity chief of the multinational company, the cybersecurity chief of billion-dollar company told me, he attended an international conference on cybersecurity, presented a technical paper. There was a German professor who also presented a technical paper, and during the coffee break, they were talking to each other about their papers that they presented. They exchanged visiting cards, and then he went to United States, the guy went back to Germany Few weeks later, he got a mail from the German professor saying that, please recall that during the coffee break, we talked about some technical issues. I make some certain suggestions and so on and so forth. And the correspondence went between them for the next 6 months. At the end of 6 months, they met at another international conference, cybersecurity summit. And this head of cybersecurity of this $500 billion US company went up to the German professor and said, thank you very much for your mail and all that. We corresponded and so on. And the German professor turned in and said, what mail? I never sent you a single mail. And then because this guy was the head of cybersecurity, he went back to the old international conference which he attended, and I hope that you having CCTV cameras here to monitor everything that is taking place here, he went back, and then when he went there, he found that while he was talking and having coffee with these people, there were two Chinese people who were behind them just noting down what these people were talking about. They hacked into the German professor's computer, and through the computer they sent a mail to this person. And you would never believe it, because you always think that if you were to send me a mail saying that, you know, look at this conference, you said about, you gave this example, I'll think it is you. But this is the way you have to be careful about. The cybersecurity threat is so alive, and it is there every day of your life. And you have to, unless you are aware about it, you are going to be in real big trouble.